Say this with me. Say, this is my Bible. This is the Word of God. This is God speaking unto me. Within this Word, there's life. Life into my body. Health into my flesh. Strength into my bones. Wisdom into my mind. Within the Word of God contains every answer to every problem I'll face in this life. And when I hear the Word, when I read the Word, when I speak the Word, I'm built up, I'm edified, I'm charged up, I'm strengthened, I'm lifted up. And when I come to church, I come expecting to hear the Word of God and to experience the presence of God. And I declare today, I will not leave here the same, but I will leave here changed in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as you know, this is the beginning of the year. It's first Sunday of 2016. I know some of you are glad to have 2015 behind you. One of the good things about a new year is it's a fresh start. And, you know, a lot of people start making New Year's resolutions and stuff. And I would, if you could invest in this, if it was possible, I would do it every single year. Invest in like some type of stock for the first 3 weeks of gyms, health centers, because you know the next couple of weeks, memberships are going to skyrocket because everybody's making these resolutions and everybody does all these type of things to better themselves. But what usually happens with resolutions is they last for a couple of weeks and then they go away. And so what I want to do, I want to give you some principles today. I'm not a real big, you know, five step, seven key, this and that. But in this situation, I want to give you four principles for increase. I'm not saying these are the keys to increase, but these are four principles for increase that if you put these in your life, I'm guaranteeing you, you're not going to get a lot of guarantees with some things. These are guaranteed. It will produce increase, change, and growth in your life. Four principles for increase. The first one is this. You need to stay full of the Word of God. These are basic. These are elementary. But sometimes we need to be elementary. We need to be ABC-like. We need to be Sesame Street-like. And we need to stick with the basics. We need to get back to the foundation. Number one, you need to stay full of the Word of God. You need to stay full of the Word. People that are in the circles I run with, they say this about us, that we are Word people and we are Spirit people. Word and the Spirit. The first thing is you need to stay full of the Word of God. You need to stay full of the Word of God. Look over at Psalm chapter 1. This is a tremendous passage of Scripture over in Psalm. King David here, Psalm chapter 1. I want you to notice what he says here. Psalm chapter 1 and verse 1. It says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. You could say in the Word of God. His delight is there, and in the law, in the Word, he meditates day and night. He meditates day and night. That word meditate, it means to ponder. It means to think about. Or one of my favorite phrases that Lacey makes fun of me all the time, to chew on. Like a cow chews its cud. Just on it. I mean, like Jake's so funny. When he was a little kid, he still kind of does this. Not as bad, though. It was one of the funniest things. We'd go to Cracker Barrel, and Jake loves bacon. And we'd go to Cracker Barrel, and he'd get some bacon. And, you know, I eat really fast. And so I've got to watch myself. Jake would chew on bacon until it was mush. And it would still be in his mouth like an hour later, just sitting in there, just kind of caked. He would just chew on it and chew on it and chew on it. And yet, but that is what we need to do with the Word of God. We got to meditate on it. We got to think about it. We got to ponder it. And what happens is you begin to renew your mind and you begin to change the way that you think and you begin to line up your thoughts with God's thoughts. That your thoughts begin to change and they become His. He said, blessed. And what does that word blessed mean? Come on, we know it around here. The word blessed means what? Empowered. In the Hebrew and Greek, it means empowered to prosper. So you can put that in there. He said, empowered to prosper is the man whose delight is in the law of the Lord. Well, how many of you want to prosper? And I'm not talking about just financially. We ought to be wanting to prosper in every area of our life. That is true prosperity. Prospering in your body, prospering in your family, prospering in your relationships, prospering in your finances, prospering in your job. He said, you are empowered to prosper when you do this. So when he tells you this is a key to prospering, then that ought to open up your eyes, that ought to open up your ears, and you ought to start paying attention. He said, the man who delights in the law, the man who delights in the Word of God, and not just a chapter that I agree with and then I take out a chapter that I don't, but delights in the Word and meditates on the Word day and night. He said, this is the results of it. He said, he's going to be like a tree that's planted by the rivers of the water that brings forth its fruit in season. So see, we want to bring forth fruit, right? We don't want to be a tree that doesn't do anything. I'm not somebody that likes to just go through my day and not do anything. I like to accomplish things. I'm very goal-oriented. And there's a lot of people around me that are like that. I am kind of an overachiever a lot of times. I want to produce fruit. That's what I care about. I want to produce fruit. For God, I want to produce fruit. I'm not satisfied with just going through life, going and being the status quo, being average, being normal. That has never been me. That never will be me. I want to produce fruit. And he said, you are empowered to do this if you will do this. Meditate in the Word of God. Stay full of it. Stay filled with it. He said, you'll be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. It will bring forth fruit in its season. And check out this. He said, and your leaf, it will never wither. It will never wither. I believe it's the Amplified that talks about in a drought. So even in the tough times, even in the hard times, if you stay full of the Word of God, you won't get taken out. And you won't get taken down. Even when there's rough times in the economy, if the economy begins to tank, if there's drought, if there's famine, if there's terror, if you stay full of the Word of God, then you're going to continue to prosper. Your fruit is going to continue to grow. The leaf is not going to wither. Nothing's going to take you out. In other words, the things that are going on in this world, they are not going to affect you. Why? Because if you're full of the Word of God, then you're going to be full of faith. Come on, where does faith come from? The Bible tells us that faith comes by what? Hearing the Word of God. And so if there's a continual flow of the Word of God in your life, then there's going to be a continual flow of faith coming out of your mouth. Come on. Jesus said what over Mark 11:23? He said what? Whosoever believes, whoever says unto this mountain, be removed, be cast into the sea, and doesn't doubt in his heart, but believes that those things that he says will come to pass, he will have whatever he says. He'll have whatever he saith. And so even when there's obstacles around, if you're full of the Word of God, if you're thinking the way that God thinks, you won't see an obstacle. You won't see a mountain as a mountain. You'll just see it as a molehill. You'll just step on it, and you'll keep on going. But you won't be like the world that goes, whoa, I can't go any further anymore. The world is going to look at things as limitations. They're going to look at things as, oh, that must be God's lot for my life. That must be God's will for my life. But when you know the Word of God and negative situations come against you, you're not going to go the way of the world, and you're not going to go the way of religious Christians. You're going to go the way of God, and when there's an obstacle, you tell it to get out of the way. Why? Because you understand you have authority in this world, that you may be in this world, but you're not of this world. And so the things of this world will not affect you. We looked at it last week. Galatians chapter 3, verse 13 says that Christ, he has redeemed us from the curse of the law. And what was really interesting about that is that word redeem, it is the picture of a man who goes to a slave market with the intention of buying a slave to set him free. With the intention of setting them free. And so that is exactly what Jesus did for you and I. He became sin for us, so he became the curse for us, so that the things of this world, this cursed world, does not have to affect you and I. We can live in a cursed world and yet not live a cursed life. Or you can say it like this, we can live in a cursed world and yet still live a very blessed life. But it all starts with staying full of the Word of God. He said, blessed is the man who does what? Who delights in the Word, who meditates in the Word, and because of that, you'll continually produce fruit. Your leaf will not wither. And then look at the last part. And he said, and whatever he does, what? Shall what? Prosper. I don't know about you, but when I see the word prosper, my mind lights up. Because I know that my prosperity, my version of prosperity, isn't even near to what God's version of prosperity is. Come on now. We look at gold and silver and this and that. We look at it as, wow. And God, it's just so common to him, it's just building materials. Right? I mean, God sees things so much greater than us. And when God's telling you this is how you can prosper, you and I ought to be going, wow, I need to pay attention to that. He's telling you, if you will delight in the Word of God, if you will make it first place. Remember, Jesus said this in Matthew 6:33. Seek first, what? Kingdom of God and His righteousness. And then all the stuff, all these things, they'll be added to you. But put God first. Put the Word of God first. Put it first. Delight in it. Chew on it. Meditate on it. Think about it. Mutter it. That's what it means to meditate. You keep it on your mind. And what is on your mind, that is what will come out of your mouth. And if the Word of God is coming out of your mouth, God said over in Isaiah, He said, I will not allow my Word to go forth and return unto me void. It will go forth and it will accomplish what it was sent to do. So when you're speaking the Word of God and you're speaking it in faith, it's guaranteed that what's coming out, it will come to pass. And He tells you this is a way that you can prosper. This is a key. This is a very, very huge key, a principle of the Word of God and how to prosper. I mean, if God says whatever you, if you'll do this, whatever you do, you'll prosper, that's something you need to make note of. He said, whatever you do will prosper. Whatever you do will prosper. Look over at 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16. This is a familiar passage, scripture for a lot of you. I'm sure you've heard this. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16, it says, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it's profitable for what? Doctrine, for reproof. See, we don't like that. For correction. See, we don't like that. And for instruction in righteousness. Sometimes we don't like the instruction either. But, he said, it's profitable for this so that the man of God or the woman of God would be what? Complete and would be thoroughly equipped for every good work. So, I don't know about you, but I like to go into a situation knowing I've got all the goods. I've got everything I need to be a success. And he's telling you, this is one of the keys, this is one of the deals here, is that the Word of God, it's profitable for doctrine. In other words, it's going to set the boundaries for you, it's going to set the limits for you. And see, limits are really actually good. A lot of people today don't like fences, they don't like the boundaries of the Word of God, but it's actually good because it's actually freedom. That's why kids thrive on rules. Now, they may tell you they don't like it, but I'm telling you, kids, they thrive on rules. They thrive on having boundaries. Why? Because within the boundaries, there's freedom. They know what they can do. They know what they can't do. They know there's freedom there. And he says it's profitable for doctrine. It's profitable for reproof, for correction. So in other words, what he's getting at, it will keep you in the straight line. It will keep you from getting off in a ditch. And the problem that you and I are seeing today is that we live in a society today that's not looking to the Word of God for doctrine, not looking to the Word of God for correction, for reproof, for instruction. It's looking to all these other sources, and that is why that we're seeing the church as a whole beginning to falter. We're seeing people running from the church. We're seeing denominations beginning to fall, to crumble. Why? Because we're getting away from God's Word, and we're going over there where we're concerned about people's opinions, and we're concerned about people being offended, and we're concerned about money going out the door, and it's what it's telling you is we're trusting in people, and we're not really trusting in God. I mean, what's happened over the last year has been absolutely incredible when it comes to the church. I mean, we are seeing denomination after denomination walking away from what the Word of God says in regards to marriage, which has been a big one. Major denominations coming out and saying, well, this isn't relevant anymore. It's not relevant anymore. And so we're just going to go with what, you know, the world's saying. And so you have denominations embracing homosexuality. And not just embracing homosexuality as something that is good and something that is normal and natural, but also beginning to promote it within the area of ministry. One of the things that was very alarming to me was there is a major denomination, actually it's the largest denomination in the United States, and they don't believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Well, that's fine. If you don't want to believe it, that's fine. I mean, nobody's knocking this or that. I mean, it's obviously here. It's very much true. We're very much encouraged to go after that, something Jesus died for. But not criticizing anybody for not seeing the light of that, but that has been their conviction for a very, very long time. And yet now they have come out and said, well, we still don't agree with it. We don't believe in it. But if you don't agree with it, it's okay, we're not going to kick you out of the church. And if you're a minister and you don't agree with it, well, we're not going to take away your license. Now, a lot of people in the charismatic, spirit-filled world got all excited and said, yes, they're starting to see the light. It scared the bejeebies out of me. And this is why. It was not exciting to me. It did not make me want to cheer and shout. Because what it's telling me is that here yet is another group that is willing to let go of its convictions. And the reason they were willing to do this is because they were losing people to spirit-filled denominations. And they point blank said it. The president of the association said, we are losing people all over the world to spirit-filled denominations. We realized we had to make a change. And so instead of kicking people out and taking away their licenses and ordinations, we're telling them, we don't agree with it, but we'll let you stay. And what it's telling me is, here again is another group that's willing to compromise on their convictions for the sake of not losing people and not losing money and not losing influence. And when you start to go down that slippery slope and you begin to slide down, all of a sudden the doors begin to open up for other things. When this stops being your standard, when this stops being your conviction, you're opening the door up for anything and everything. What you are doing is you're knocking down the fence. And once the fence is gone, you don't know how far you can go without falling off the cliff. And so you just keep walking and walking and walking. No, this has got to be your conviction. This has got to be your standard of living. And I'm not just talking about your lifestyle. I mean, I'm talking about this is you. Because if you're not paying attention to what's going on in the world, it could be a little scary. Because our government has ceased to be a government that's ruled by the Constitution, ruled by the people, for the people. It's being ruled by corrupt judges. It's being ruled by corrupt politicians. It's not being ruled according to the Word of God in which it was founded at all. Not anymore. It ain't happening anymore. Now we've got politicians, Republicans and Democrats. I'm fed up with both of them. I'm fed up with the whole thing. Because I don't see any of them staying with this. It's all about where the money's at. That's where it's at. No, our country was founded on this. And the further you get away from this, the further you get away from God's blessing, the further you get away from God's prosperity, the further you get away from God's holiness and His righteousness. And that's why right now in our world, in our country, our schools are going to shambles, our Congress, our politicians, our government's going to shambles. Why? Because you cannot prosper without the Word of God. That is why He said, if you will stay with this, you will prosper in everything that you do. It is the reason that America, for over 250 years, has been the most prosperous nation in the world, and yet now we are falling behind and behind and behind. We are not the most prosperous nation anymore. China is. China owns most of our debt. We are not the example for all of the world anymore. Why? Because when you get away from the Word of God as your standard and your conviction, there is no blessing there. You make the decision, I'm not going to walk in the blessing for the sake of appeasing people and not making people mad, and for money, I'm just going to walk in the curse. And that's what's going on. And yet, the wonderful thing is that even though our country may be going that way, even though our politics may be going that way, the church does not have to go that way. But even though some of the church may be going that way, I'm telling you, the Bible, you should be so excited when you look around. Don't get sad. Look around at everything that's going on, because all it is the Bible playing out. It's the Word of God playing out. The Bible explicitly says that in the last days, there's going to be a great falling away of the church. And so when you begin to see the church beginning to shake and the church beginning to rock, hey, don't get upset, don't cry, don't whine. You ought to be getting excited, because that means there's a rumbling and a shaking going on. And all the fluff's going to get out, all the entertainment's going to get out, all the money changers are going to get out, all the junk's going to get out, and all of a sudden you're going to see the pure church once again thriving, not just trying to survive, but thriving and shining bright like we were planned to, experiencing the supernatural, signs and wonders and miracles, and the world looking and saying, oh my God, what is that? It's what's going to happen. See, sometimes there has to be some weeding taking place so things can thrive. It's exactly what's going to go on. And it's exactly what is going on right now. And the reason these things are taking place is simply because of this. people are going away from the Word of God. It's very simple. People want that. We want more complex things, but the gospel is simple. God is simple in this. It comes down to this. You've got to stay full of the Word. You've got to. You've got to. You've got to. Otherwise, you're going to be swayed by popular opinion. You're going to be swayed by all these different doctrines that are going on out there that, you know, there is no hell and everybody's going to heaven and you can just live however you want and it's grace, grace, grace. Thank God for grace. Thank God for the blood of Jesus, you know. But you can't take the grace of God in vain. You can't stomp on the blood of Jesus and say, oh, well, I'm going to do whatever I want. You can't do that. Thank God for redemption. Thank God for grace. But anytime you find people looking for excuses to live however they want, it's telling you they're straying. They're straying from this. You got to stick with this. And I'm not one of these rules, and do's and don'ts. I'm just telling you, if you love God, then you will stick with His Word. People say, oh, I want to hear from God. Open up the Bible and hear from God. And yet what happens is you get goofy people who based on opinion, not based on the Word, based on opinion, they want to tell you what God's like and what Jesus is like. A couple of weeks ago, I had this one lady telling me, didn't agree with some things, and telling me, well, and doesn't really believe in this, but tells me, well, the first thought that comes to my mind is, what would Jesus do? And goes on to tell what Jesus would do. And yet, it's an absolute contrast to exactly what Jesus did. I mean, verbatim, black and white. Jesus would not do what she said Jesus would do. But in her carnal mind and being ruled by senses and popular opinion, it would seem to be that that's what Jesus would do. But it was not what Jesus would do. Why? If you would just read your Bible, if you just read this a couple of passages of Scripture here, you find out that ain't what Jesus would do. Because it goes absolutely against the law of love. Not there. So number one, we need to be full of what? We need to be full of the Word. We need to be full of the Word. Number two, we need to be full of the Holy Ghost. We need to stay filled with the Spirit of God. Look over at Acts chapter 6. So number one, we need to stay full of the Word. Number two, we need to stay full of the Spirit of God. Acts chapter 6 and verse 1, the church has now been formed. In Acts chapter 1, you see Jesus being seated at the right hand of God. And then in Acts chapter 2, He sends the Spirit of God to come down, and you see the 120 in the upper room. They receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And yes, the baptism of the Holy Spirit is still very much for today. Still very much for today. Around here, we are not ashamed of it. We are not offended by it. We promote it. We live by it. And it's who we are. And it's the reason we see miracles. People say, well, I don't know why we're not seeing the miracles today. It's because people are backing away from the Holy Ghost. They're putting Him in a back room. They're concerned that He's going to offend somebody. No, God's smarter than that. The reason that He sent the Spirit of God was so you and I could be a witness to the world through signs and wonders and miracles. If you find a church that doesn't believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you're also going to find a church that is not seeing the miraculous. And yet you're also going to find a church that because they're not pushing that, because they're not seeing the miraculous, they're not going to be able to be a witness for God the way that He designed. What's going to happen is you're going to fall back onto your natural wisdom, natural senses on how to reach people spiritually. It doesn't work. You can't use natural means to try to produce spiritual results. But anyway, got to be filled with what? The Word, and filled with what? Filled with the Holy Spirit, filled with the Spirit of God. And so the church is formed, it's growing. And in Acts chapter 6 and verse 1 it says, now in those days when the number of the disciples were doing what? Multiplying. See, God loves increase. He's all about increase. Multiplying. There arose a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists because the widows were being neglected in the daily distribution of food. And the 12, they summoned the multitude of the disciples and said, it's not desirable that we should leave the Word of God and serve tables. Therefore, brethren, and it wasn't that they weren't willing to do it. They had been doing it, but they had to get back to their focus. They had to get back to what their responsibility was. Verse 3, it says, therefore, brethren, seek out from among you seven men of good reputation. Notice this, and they're full of what? Full of the Holy Ghost, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we can appoint over this business. See, they were looking for wait staff, and they didn't even want their wait staff to not be filled with the Holy Ghost. They wanted their servers to be Spirit-filled, Word-filled, Spirit-filled. Or you could say they wanted their volunteers to be Spirit-filled. People helping out to be Spirit-filled. This was obviously very, very, very important to them. They said, I want you to find people of good reputation, and I want people full of the Holy Ghost. I want people full of the Holy Ghost. Why? Because this is ministry here. It's all ministry. He said, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom so we can appoint over this business, so we can give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the Word. And then verse 7 says, the Word of God did what? Spread. Again, it began to increase. It began to multiply. And the number of the disciples, what? Multiplied greatly in Jerusalem. And a great many of the priests were obedient to the faith. And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and signs among the people. See, Stephen was one of the ones that they appointed to help there. And one of the things that we see with Stephen was that he was full of the Holy Ghost and he was full of faith. Well, you can't be full of faith unless you're full of the Word. So you see a gentleman here, he's full of the Word and he's full of the Holy Ghost. And what happens is that he began to serve in little things. And yet because he stayed full, God did what? God promoted him. He exalted him. See, we think that you need to be very learned for God to use you. God doesn't need a learned man. He needs a filled man. He doesn't need a learned woman. He needs a filled woman. He needs a man and a woman full of the Word of God and full of the Holy Ghost. And what will happen? He will take a nobody and fill that nobody with the Spirit of God and turn that nobody into a somebody. It doesn't matter your background. It doesn't matter your past. It doesn't matter what you've done. If you will be faithful to what God has called you and you will stay full of the Word of God and stay full of the Holy Ghost, God will use you. He will promote you and He will take you to supernatural levels and use you in supernatural ways that you never even dreamed or thought God would do. People say, well, what do I got to do to be promoted in ministry? Stay full of the Word. Stay full of the Holy Ghost. Well, what do I need to do to be promoted, you know, in serving in church? Stay full of the Word and stay full of the Holy Ghost. Well, what do I need to do to see my marriage get better? Stay full of the Word and stay full of the Holy Ghost. Well, what do I need to do to get promoted at work? You need to stay full of the Word and stay full of the Holy Ghost. You got to stay full because what you are full of, that is what will come out of your mouth. And that is what you will do. That is how you will respond. When the devil comes up and he tries to pressure you and push your buttons, the only thing that will come out is what the Word of God would say and what the Spirit of God is leading you to do. That's all that's going to come out. Why? Because you're not leaving any room for junk. You're not leaving any room for the world. You're not leaving any room for oppression or opinions or frustrations and doubts. And you're not leaving room for any of that. Why? Because you're staying full. Because you're staying full. Smith Wigglesworth, a man who had raised over 20 people from the dead back in the early 1900s, he said this. He said, a real Christian should never leave his house without being full of the Holy Ghost. He says, you should never leave his house without being full of the Holy Ghost. And you may say, well, Pastor, I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit a long time ago. That doesn't mean that you're full. Well, I got saved, and you know, I know that I'm the temple of God, and the Spirit of God lives on the inside of me. That does not mean that you are full. Does not mean that you are full. Look over at Ephesians. I'll show you an interesting passage of Scripture here. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18. Listen to what Paul said here. He said, do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, or in which is excess. But he said, I want you to be filled with the Spirit. You have to understand, he is writing to the church at Ephesus. They are a Spirit-filled church. If you go back and read in Acts, in the book of Acts, we see where the people in Ephesus, they received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So Paul is talking to people that's already received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and yet he's saying, be filled with the Holy Spirit. When you begin to look at what the Greek says here, this phrase, be filled, is the present continual. In other words, Paul is saying, be being filled. That's the way that it literally reads in the Greek. Be being filled. So in other words, be constantly filled. Be being filled. Continue to be filled. Continue to stay filled. And he said, continue to be filled, be being filled with the Spirit. Verse 19, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father. So what he's letting you know is, one of the ways that you can stay full of the Holy Ghost is to keep your mind on the Word of God and keep the Word of God coming out of your mouth. Because what it really means to be filled with the Spirit, to be full of the Spirit, is that you are so totally aware of God. You're so totally aware of the presence of God on the inside of you. It doesn't matter what you see. It doesn't matter what you hear. It doesn't matter what you feel. It will not move you. Why? Because you're full of the Word and you're full of the Holy Ghost. To be filled with the Spirit of God is a continual thing. Just because you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, yes, you received it, but that doesn't mean that you're full. Because it's actually interesting that you'll find when you read over there in Acts chapter 2, the same group that received the baptism of the Holy Spirit there, you read over in chapter 4, it says that that same group, they begin to pray. And it says that the house was shaken and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. This is the same group that two chapters before had already received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So they had received it, but then they got full again. They got full again. So in other words, you can stay full. You can stay empty. You can stay full. One of the ways that you begin to check and see if you're full, this is a little telltale sign. It's one I can always see for me. When I start to get a little fleshy, when I start to have some little fits of carnality, when I start to get a little jumpy, when I start to get a little agitated, that is a sign for me I haven't been spending enough time praying in the Holy Ghost. It's a sign for me. And so what I got to do is I got to go back and I got to have some me and God time. We got to talk. We got to spend some time together. I need to be praying. But what I do to try to avoid that is I'm always, almost always spending time praying in the Spirit. Smith Wigglesworth said this. Someone once asked him, he said, how long do you pray in the Spirit? And Smith Wigglesworth said, I only prayed 10 minutes. And they said, only 10 minutes? And Smith said, yeah, but I never go more than 10 minutes without praying. He said, I only spend about 10 minutes praying in the Spirit, but I never go more than 10 minutes without praying in the Spirit. See, what Smith was doing is he was staying full. He was staying full because you do not know, you never know what situation is going to present itself this afternoon, tomorrow morning, 2 or 3 days from now. You don't know. And so you've got to be ready. You've got to be ready. And the way that you can be ready is you stay full of the Word and you stay full of the Holy Ghost. So that way when a situation presents itself, you don't begin to speak doubt. You don't begin to speak unbelief. You speak what the Word of God says. And you're directed by the Holy Ghost. See, Jesus said this over in John chapter 15, verse 7. He said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, he said, you will ask for whatever you want and it shall be given unto you. He said, if you abide in me, and this is what this word abide is talking about, staying full of the Word and staying full of the Holy Ghost. The word abide means to stay put, means to stay, to make it a permanent dwelling place. He said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire. Now see, it's not about just desiring whatever you want. See, if you're full of the Word, then you're going to desire the things of God. You're going to desire what He desires. And then because you desire what He desires, then you're going to begin to declare and speak out what He wants. And because you're speaking out His Word and what He wants, and you're doing it by faith, it's guaranteed it's going to come to pass. And that's why Jesus said, if you'll ask what you desire, it will be done. And yet the interesting thing is this word ask in the Greek, it literally means this, to adamantly demand with expectation of receiving. Powerful. That one little word ask. In the Greek, it literally means to adamantly demand with the intention of receiving. And he said, it will be done for you. See, it's all about being full. Being full of the Word, being full of the Holy Ghost. And the result of being full is you're not going to be swayed. The result of being full of the Word is you're going to be full of faith. The result of being full of the Holy Ghost is you're only going to say what He says. You're going to be directed how He directs you. You're going to respond in love. You're going to respond by the Holy Ghost and not be responding by your flesh, not be responding by your senses, not be responding by popular opinion. And you'll do what you need to do, and you'll always be in the right place at the right time. Jesus said over in John chapter 16, He said that the Holy Spirit, that He will reveal things to come. So see, you don't have to always be in the dark about what's going to happen. It says He will show you things to come. He'll show you things to come. Now, don't you think you would have an advantage in life if you know some things ahead of time? Come on now. If I can know some things ahead of time, please tell me. Because that means I don't have to make a bad decision. It means I can be in the right place at the right time. I don't have to miss out on something good coming my way. Because I'm telling you, there's a lot of things we've missed out on that God was trying to get us because we weren't in the right place at the right time. And we missed out. And then we go on through life and wonder, well, how come God, how come this hasn't showed up? Because you didn't show up in the right place. He said He will reveal, He will show you things to come. So you need to stay full of the Word. You need to stay full of the Holy Ghost. Because I'm telling you, somebody that's full of the Holy Ghost, somebody that's filled with the Spirit of God, the supernatural will be natural for you. It will be normal for you. Signs and wonders and miracles will be normal for you. There is absolutely nothing impossible for somebody that is filled with the Spirit of God. And I'm not talking about somebody that received the baptism of the Holy Spirit 20 years ago. I'm talking about somebody that's filled. Full right now. I mean, saturated with Him, permeated with Him, oozing out of every cell, every pore of your body. And yet, do you realize you could be full right now and then, oh, maybe 20, 30 minutes later, not be so full? And by tomorrow, just be, oh, where's God? I mean, that's what happens a lot of times. People come to church and we've sung, we've worshiped, we've praised God, we've got our mind on Him. We get into the Word, and our mind's being renewed, and we're ready to take on the world. Bring it on, devil. Bring on everything you've got. You're no match for me. I'm filled with God. I got God on the inside of me. And then Monday morning, God, are you here? Where's God? God feels like He's just a million miles away. Why? Because this is what David was talking about over in Psalm chapter 1. Continually meditate day and night. To ponder, to chew, to think about. It is a battle. It is a battle in this world for your mind. It's a battle in this world for your attention. You have got to make this. This is a thing that you do intentionally. Intentionally. I mean, when we're at Walmart and pushing the cart, man, I'm praying in tongues. I'm praying in the Spirit. I'm not getting all crazy and woo! I'm not doing all that. I'm not spitting and slobbering all over everybody. I mean, see, you can be supernatural and yet be normal. And this right here, friends, this right here is why most of Christendom, when they hear Spirit-filled, they think flaky. They think weird. They think Fruit Loop, Frosted Flake, Corn Pop, Honey Nut, Cheerio. Because they correlate Spirit-filled with nuts, with flaky, with fruity. And I don't blame them. Because most of us, I'll say this about most Spirit-filled places. And I say it because I is one. Most Spirit-filled places, most Spirit-filled churches and stuff, you'll find a lot of people that will allow the Holy Ghost to move them to run and shout and dance and holler and swing from the chandeliers and be on the ground and get up with their shirt out and carpet in their teeth, but won't allow the Holy Ghost to move them to forgive somebody. And won't allow the Holy Ghost to move them to give to somebody. Well, I got a question. If the Holy Ghost can move you to run and dance and shout, but the Holy Ghost can't get you to give and love, you got a question. Is it the Holy Ghost? Well, but see, this is the thing. If you're full of the Word and you're full of the Holy Ghost, you'll be a giver. I'm telling you, if you want to increase in the area of finances, you ought to want to be a giver. You need to decide to be a giver. The Bible says over in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, actually turn over there real quick, we'll finish up. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, and that whole chapter is just really good, but just to give you a little taste of it here. 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 10. Notice what he says here, because I don't know anybody that doesn't want to prosper financially. I don't know anybody that doesn't want to increase financially. He said in 2 Corinthians 9 and verse 10, he said, "Now may he who supplies seed to the sower," talking about God, "he'll supply seed to who?" Now see, if you're a sucker, if you're a sucker, you're not getting no seed. He said, but if you're a sower, God will give you the seed. And what's the purpose of the seed? Well, the seed, when it's planted, it'll come back as a harvest. And there'll be more than what was sown. But he said, he'll supply seed to the sower, not the sucker, to the sower. And supply bread for food. So not only supply the seed for you to sow, he'll also supply what you need. So he'll supply the material things, but he'll also supply the seed for you to increase. So this is letting you know that your method of increase is not your job. Your method of increase is your giving. We don't go to work for a living. We go to work for our giving. It is a major channel of seed. And if you want to increase financially, you've got to be a giver. We've been telling you repeatedly, if you will learn to be a giver, then God will supply your habit. If you learn to be a distributor, God, he'll be your supplier. He'll be your supplier. Come on, some of you that were drug addicts and drug dealers, you know, be a distributor, you got to have a supplier. God's letting you know, he will meet your habit. If you'll be a distributor, he will be your supplier, because that is what God is looking for. He's looking for people that will be a distributor for him, because he's trying to get things to people in this world. And if he's leading you to do something, if he's leading you to give to somebody, come on, you know it's not you, and you know it's not the devil. It has to be God, so just do it. Because if God's leading you to be a blessing to somebody and give to somebody, it's twofold. He's trying to get something to somebody, and he's also trying to get something to you. He's trying to get the goods to them, and he's trying to get seed to come out of your hand into the ground so that somebody else can come and be a distributor for you. And this is God's method. It's his principle, primary principle for increase. If you're full of the Word and full of the Holy Ghost, one of the primary results is you will learn to be a giver. You will desire to be a giver, because that is what God is. He is a giver. Come on, we know this. John chapter 3 and verse 16 says, "For God so loved that he gave." And if you love, if you are a lover, you will be a giver. If God is your Father, and you are staying full of what he says and thinking like he thinks and talking like he talks, then you'll do like he does. And you'll be a giver. You'll be a giver. And if you go on and finish reading here, he said that he would supply the seed, multiply it. He'll multiply it. And he'll increase the fruits of your righteousness. Verse 11, it says, while you, listen, check this out, while you are enriched in what things? Everything. While you are enriched in everything for all liberality, which causes thanksgiving through us to God. So see, this is why we make our confession over our finances. We include this in there. So we have more than enough to be a blessing. More than enough to be a blessing to the body of Christ and fulfill all that God has called us to do. It's right here. We're enriched in everything. Or in other words, we have more than enough for every situation to be a blessing in every single place. See, this right here is why you don't have to go sit on the corner with a bucket and a cheesy shirt and beg people to give to your building fund. I'm fed up with it. I'm so tired of it, because it's a slap in the face of God. It's telling the world that the God that we serve and the God that sent us here to tell you about redemption is requiring us to depend on you financially to get the word out to you, to save you, because our God isn't big enough. That is what it's promoting. What it's telling people is, we don't believe God, but we want you to. Come on now. Let's get real about this. This flaky Christianity mess, this soft, spineless Christianity, come on, that isn't God. We're talking about the Jesus that we follow, that when taxes were due, he said, go fishing. He didn't say, go to the market, put up a sign, and see if we can get the rest of the Jewish people to give. But see, when you're not full of the Word, and you're not full of the Holy Ghost, and inspired by the Holy Ghost, you will resort to worldly means to take care of yourself. I think it's a slap in the face of Christianity when the church goes out to the world and says, help us do the things of God. It's horrible. And I don't want to be a part of any of that. I hate that mess. I hate it when I turn on TV and the preacher's saying, if you don't give, we're not going to be here next week. You need to get off the air then. That isn't anybody I want to follow. I don't want to follow somebody that's full of doubt and unbelief. Why would I want to follow somebody that says I'm a leader of God when they don't even believe Him? If you're full of the Word and full of the Holy Ghost, you will do things that will go absolutely contrary to what common sense says do. And because of that, you will give even when it doesn't look like it's a good time to give. Why? Because when the Holy Spirit leads you to give, you know that's the right time to give. All you got to do is learn to follow Him. He'll teach you and lead you to be a giver. And the last thing that He will lead you to do is the fourth principle there. You need to stay full of the Word, full of the Holy Ghost. You need to be a giver. And the last thing is you need to be a lover. You have got to maintain your love walk. If you're full of the Word, full of the Holy Ghost, this will take care of itself. But you got to constantly remind yourself, I'm going to walk in love. I don't care what anybody says. I don't care what anybody does. I don't care how the devil comes and tries to offend me. I refuse to be offended. I refuse to be a partaker or a partner in divisiveness. Come on, look at what Paul said about this. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12. Real quick, Colossians chapter 3 and verse 12. He said, therefore, Colossians 3, verse 12, therefore, as the elect of God, that's who you and I are, holy and beloved. He said, I want you to put on mercy, put on kindness, humility, meekness, and long-suffering. I want you to bear with one another. That means there's going to be some people around you that's going to drive you batty. And he said, bear with them. Deal with it. Deal with it. And there's lots of husbands and wives right now punching each other. Said, deal with it. And notice he said, forgive one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all of these things, I want you to put on love, which is the bond of perfection. In other words, the love of God, it is the glue that will hold you together. It is the glue that will hold everything together. He said, above all of this, you put on love. It is the bond of perfection. Over in Ephesians, Paul said, don't be angry. Don't let the sun go down on your anger and sin not. And he goes on to tell us, he said, you need to know what the devil's trying to do. He's trying to come after you. He's trying to hurt you. But if you'll stay in love, this won't be an obstacle. It won't be an obstacle for you. If you know ahead of time, you're going to have to bear with some people. You're going to have to bear with some people. Come on, you know right now when you go to the restaurant, you're going to have to bear with some people. Your waiter's not going to do something right. Somebody's going to cut in front of you. Somebody's going to take your parking spot. It happened to me and Lacey. We went to Orlando. We went to the mall. We were waiting and waiting and waiting for a parking spot. Had my blinker cut on, waiting to turn in. Somebody's pulling out so I can take their spot. And somebody saw it and ran up in there and jumped in the spot. Man, oh man. I hadn't been in church in a couple of days. I was tired, been at Disney World, going to bed at 2 o'clock in the morning, getting up at 7 to 8 in the morning. You talk about having a fit of carnality. I rolled down my window. I sat there and waited for him to get out. I looked at him, I said, you know what you did? He said, what are you talking about? I said, that was my spot. He said, I just pulled in. I said, you saw me sitting here for more than 5 minutes. You saw me with my blinker on. That's my spot. He said, I don't know what you're talking about. I said, don't you lie. This is faith-filled, spirit-filled. Well, not at that moment. Not spirit-filled. Not full of the Holy Ghost. Because I got Lacey sitting right here and Jake in the back and they're laughing. I want to get out and I want to lay hands on him suddenly. Over a parking spot. But you know Christians do that over their chair in church. I'll never forget when we first showed up here, we had people getting mad because somebody took their spot. The very first thing I did, very first change, I rearranged the chairs. And I watched people. I remember we had a guy come in and they were in a place of leadership and he said, oh, I like this, but man, my wife's going to be ticked off. And I said, ticked off at what? He said, you moved her spot. I said, good. So every Sunday for about a month, I'd come in here right before service on Sunday. I'd get here and I'd rearrange all the chairs. Change it up. Praise God. So come on. What's four principles? We need what? Stay full of the Word. Stay full of the Holy Spirit. We need to be a giver. And we need to be a lover. And I guarantee you, you do those four things. You make those principles that you live by. Not resolutions. The principles that you live by, you're guaranteed increase and change in every single area. Every single area is guaranteed. You're not going to get that guarantee anywhere else, but you will get that guarantee from right here. Praise God. Say it with me. I'm full of the Word. I'm full of the Holy Ghost. I am a giver. I love to give. I'm a lover. I'm not a fighter. I'm not an offended person. I refuse to be offended. I refuse to be in division. I will walk in love at all costs. I will walk in love at all costs because I'm full of the Word and I'm full of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.